The root locus. And the root locus basically arises from the problem of understanding how the poles in a feedback system change according to the variations of the gain K, the proportional feedback. So the control scheme is a classical feedback, proportional feedback scheme. The closed loop system is the input-output transfer function of the closed loop system is this. So what we want to study through the root locus is how the poles of P, the open loop system, change into the poles of the closed loop system WS. So the poles of WS, as you see from the formula here, are the roots of the numerator of this function. Or which is the same, the zeros of 1 plus KPS. So the root locus of P are the sets of points SK as complex and K real such that it's clear that this is an implicit equation. So basically the problem is to make explicit this relation. So basically the root locus graphically represents the curves S of K. Okay. So one parameter as a function of the other. In particular, these on the complex plane, so the points of the curves you can see on the complex plane, which are the curves S of K, represent the poles of WS. And so you can have the picture of how these poles vary according to the variations of K, the gain of the feedback system. Okay. So what we want to do now is to understand how to obtain in a satisfactory way, with good approximation, the root locus of a given P of S. So clearly for an exact plot of the root locus, you can again resort to MATLAB. So I will show you also some examples on MATLAB. But again, here we want to learn how to draw with a good approximation the root locus, which is a useful tool to understand how to place the pole in a feedback system, using not only the proportional gain, K, but if this is not possible through a certain proportional gain, proportional feedback, as we have seen in the case of Nyquist criteria, will be able to do this with more general kind of feedbacks, so proportional plus derivative. Okay. Again, using the root locus. Okay. So what I'm saying here is that it is not possible, as we have seen, that it is not possible stabilizing a system with only proportional feedback. We need also derivative in general, the derivative part of the controller. Okay, for example, the double integrator, as we have seen this example in the case of Nyquist criterion, a very similar situation will be here. It is not possible to place the poles of the feedback system using only proportional feedback in general. We need also derivative, the derivative part of the controller. Okay, so in general, using multiple proportional plus derivative feedbacks of controllers, it is possible to move the poles in a satisfactory way. Okay, so let's now we will see, giving also a short motivation, an explanation of what we are doing. Now we will see a certain set of rules which must be used correctly to draw the root locus. Okay, so these rules in general come from from complex analysis, in particular the properties of the analytic properties of the root locus. In particular, the analysis of the equation 1 plus KPS, which is the root locus equation. Okay. Okay, so I want to first of all go into the single rules with their explanation. I want to give you a general picture of how. Actually, yesterday we see an example, but I want to give you the general picture, in particular, what a root locus looks like in general. So we will see the single rules in detail. Okay, first of all, we have to start from PS. Okay, the starting point is to rewrite PS in a certain form, in a certain canonical form. And this is very similar as a situation when we draw the Bode plots. When we draw the Bode plots, we have to rewrite PS in the Bode form. And then, so in this way, we can identify the constant, monomial, binomial, and trinomial terms. So here we have a similar situation. And we have to write PS in the zero pole form. So the Bode form basically is a form which characterizes, rather characterizes the constants, the time constants, the damping, and the natural frequencies. The zero pole form characterizes rather the zeros and the poles as they are, because we need these values in the root locus. Okay, so in general, we need to have P in this form. Which is a zero pole form. Okay. So you see that we have M zeros and N poles and N is strictly greater than M. So it's important that the function PS be strictly proper. And this is an important remark because some of the rules will give for the root locus plotting will not be valid if P of S is proper, simply proper. So, P of S must be strictly proper. In general, this amounts to the fact that D matrix in the state space realization is zero. So no direct input-output relation. Okay. Basically, this means P of S, input-output transfer function, strictly proper. Okay. What we have to do if, for example, we have something like this. So you see, that this is not in pole 0, pole 4. Okay, so remember that you have first, before plotting the root locus, you have to write PS in 0, pole 4. So if it's not, you have to rewrite PS in this form. The problem is that if you, when you rewrite PS, you may have some constant out, like in this case. So you see that if you rewrite in zero pole form, you get this. So you see that the difference between the zero pole form and this is the constant 2. Okay, this term and this are in the zero pole form. In particular, you have 1, 0 at 0.5. One pole at 0 and another pole at minus 1. However, you see that you have a constant outside. So how to handle this constant? Okay, this is a very important passage. Otherwise, you will get wrong conclusion and results. Any constant you have outside of P, when you rewrite it in zero pole form, should be included in K. So this corresponds to a rescaling of the parameter K. Okay, so this means that if P is this, so basically, you see that you can rewrite this as P tilde of S multiplied 2, where P tilde is in 0 pole 4. Okay, P tilde is this here. Yeah. So now you see that the root locus equation is rewritten in this form. Well, now P tilde is in zero pole form as required, but well, this. So you are not K, you have 2K. So what you have to do? Reparametrize K. So K prime . So in few words, this means that you will draw the root locus of P tilde and the parameter is not anymore K, but K prime. So, so the points here will be not as K, but as K prime. Using P tilde, which is PS in zero pole form. So the values of the parameters, so there you want, you obtain from the analysis of the root locus, in particular, for example, for placing some poles in some regions, then should be carried back to the original values of K using the reparametrizing equation. Okay, so you obtain the values of K prime and get back. And so you have the values of K in the original feedback system. So unfortunately you have to do this because the rules for the root locus must be used for a P of S in zero pole form. So if necessary, first you have to rewrite P in zero pole form and reparametrize K. This may have important consequences if you don't do this, in the sense that you may do errors, significant errors in your analysis if you ignore this point. For example, in this situation, P of S must be rewritten in zero pole form in this way. So this in zero pole form. And so you have that the constant outside is minus one. So this means that you have to reparametrize in this way. If you don't do this, you see that you are exchanging basically the positive locus with the negative locus. So if you are not taking into account this minus in your root locus, basically the result will be that you believe to look at the root locus, at the positive root locus, but actually you are looking at the negative root locus. Okay? And clearly this may have dramatic consequences for the correct pole placement. Okay. So this is an important point and cannot be ignored. Okay, so the general situation we will come up with will be this.
for a root locus of a certain P of S. So assume to have n zeros and n poles okay. First of all, we'll decide to represent the poles, in particular the points of the root locus coinciding with the poles P, I, so the open loop poles. Okay, these are open loop poles and zeros, so are the zeros and poles of P. So the points of the locus which coincide with the poles are represented, we decide to represent these points with a cross. So for example, okay, so this will be P1, P2, and P3. The zeros I will do a simple example with a certain finite number of poles and zeros, in particular three poles and two zeros. The zeros will be represented with a circle. The positive locus will be represented with a continuous line. The negative locus will be represented with a dotted line, or if you want, a waving line, as you want. Dotted, but also if you want, like this. You may also use colors if you want. So remember that positive locus corresponds to variations of k in zero infinity and the negative locus variations of k in minus infinity zero. The direction is that of increasing k. Okay, what's the in general the situation for a root locus? So let's see the positive locus first. The curves of the positive locus always starts each from one pole of the open loop system. So the starting point of the curves of the locus, positive locus, are the open loop poles. So this means that the curves of the positive locus exit in some direction from each one, from one pole, one open loop pole, one for each pole. Okay, so for example, like this. Okay, so these are the, basically what I'm representing are the curves of the positive locus for values of k very close to zero. So, in few words, the value of the parameter k equals zero corresponds to the open loop poles. So, this means that the curve is exiting from the pole. This corresponds to the fact that k is increasing from zero. Okay. The zeros have a dual role in the sense that are arriving points for the curves, in particular for k equal infinity. Okay, so this means that the zeros unlike the poles, actually are limit points because they correspond to k tending to infinity. Okay, so basically we never cross the zeros. Okay, so for this reason, near the zeros, the curve is approaching the zero in this direction, because means that k is increasing to infinity and we approach in the limit that point. Okay, so in some sense, this means that the curves are attracted from the zeros. If you want, the poles, the open loop poles are sources for the curves, while the zeros are sinks. Okay, and so also the other zero. So this is in general what the curves of the positive locus look like around poles and open loop poles and zeros. So you see the curves, each one for the pole and the zero. So for each curve, one pole and one zero. They exit from the pole and go into the zero in the limit. Okay, however, you see that there is some kind of mismatch in this situation, because the poles are n and the zeros are m, and m is less than m. So it's not possible that the curves, each one starts from a pole and goes into the zero. Only m curves are ending up in the zeros. Okay. So n curves start from the poles. M of these curves end up in the zeros asymptotically, in the limit of K. And the remaining ones? Will go to, or will tend to, infinity. Okay, infinity. But this is not enough, because we are in the complex plane. So, to be precise, we cannot say simply they tend to infinity. We have to specify the direction in which the curve is tending to infinity. Okay. So the directions we see are precisely computable. Obviously, they are specified by angles, so the asymptotes. Okay, in this case, it is possible to see that the asymptotes for the positive locus, we have asymptotes for the positive locus and for the negative locus. In this case, we don't know yet, but it is possible to see that the asymptotes for infinity are two. Excuse me, are one. One for the positive locus and one for the negative locus. In particular, in this case, the asymptotes of the positive locus is this. Okay. So this means that from infinity, the curve is coming from here. Okay. The asymptote for the negative locus is on the other side, here. Okay, in this case we have only one asymptote. So you see that we, in this example, we have three poles and two zeros. So n minus m is one. So only one curve, okay, will tend to infinity. Okay. The direction is wrong. So this is the, okay. So the point is that the value, the parameter k in the limit going to infinity, basically correspond not only to one curve going to or tending to the zeros, but only to a curve tending to infinity. Okay, so the value infinity for k corresponds not only to the curve tending to the zero here, but also to the curve tending to infinity. So this means that you see you have two curves. Here, in some sense, the curves are splitting, you see. One is going in the direction of infinity and the other is going in the direction of the zero. But both correspond to k increasing and tending to infinity, okay? So, in this way, one determines the behavior of the curves near the zeros, the poles, and at infinity. Now, what you have to do to have the complete picture of the locus is to join the local pieces. So what's the intermediate behavior of the locus? So basically, this is what you do when you draw the root locus. First, you draw the root locus around zeros and poles. Respectively, around poles for small values, okay? And around zeros for large values, okay? And then at infinity, okay? Using the asymptotes, so the directions in which the curve is tending to infinity. So once, okay, you have this, you basically try to join these pieces of curves. Okay, so for example, here you see that you have two curves. One is coming out from here, and the other is coming out from here. For sure, at a certain point, these curves will intersect. So the only way in this case, we will learn this, how to handle this situation from a graphical point of view, these curves, if enters, should exit. In particular, will exit on the complex plane, outside the real axis. So, these curves will exit from the real axis in this way. They split. Okay, a very similar situation. We will study the nature of these points, you see, these intersecting points. If you remember, we have encountered these kind of points in the example we saw yesterday. And these are called singular points. Because singular points correspond to coinciding poles. Closed loop poles with multiplicity greater than one. Coinciding points. So this means that here you have a certain value k bar of the parameter for which you have, in this case, two poles which are equal at that value of the parameter. So the multiplicity of the pole at that point, k, for that value of k, is 2. So when the curves encounter each other or meet each other, at that point you have a pole with multiplicity greater than 1. In particular, you know the multiplicity by the number of the curves which are intersecting. In particular, in this case, you see two curves are intersecting, so the multiplicity is 2. If the multiplicity is 3, you will have 3 curves intersecting, and so on. So a similar situation is on the other side. You see that here, the two curves instead are departing. So, the situation now will be this, that some curves are entering that point and then departing from that point. One goes to the zero and one goes to infinity. Okay. Now, to complete, to join, okay, these two curves, one on the other, on this side, and the other on the other side. You in general use practice. So what happens here is that exactly this, that these two curves will join to these two other curves. Moreover, you can also complete this because you see that it is very natural to complete here this curve because you depart from the poles and continuously you arrive to the zero. Okay, and basically this is the complete positive locus. The negative locus is completed in a very similar way. In particular, what we can say is that the remaining part here on this of the real axis are basically occupied, are filled by the negative locus. Okay, and then you reason in a very similar way to complete also the negative locus. So this is the general picture of a root locus, and this is the way you will use the step procedure you will use according to a certain number of rules, which we will next see. Okay, and you see that basically you have to use some rules plus some practice.
Professore, solo una domanda?
Sì.
Quel curva, diciamo, che va più infinito tutta a sinistra, può ripetere da dove veniva?
Questa?
Sì.
Da dove veniva, in che senso? Cioè, che cosa da qua? Diciamo, è questa curva. Sono queste due curve, these two curves, intersect at this point and then depart from this point. One in this direction and one in this direction. Okay, because you have to, okay, you should have one curve going to infinity. Remember that P is 3 and Z is 2, so N and minus M is 1. So one curve must tend to infinity, as K tends to infinity. So this is exactly the curve which tends to infinity, and this is the curve which tends to zero. Okay, and these curves are originated here from this point into which you have these two other curves, which you see come from exactly the poles. You see, from here.
Okay, grazie.
È chiaro?
Sì, 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 grazie.
Okay.
Posso fare una domanda anch'io, professore? Sì. Ma la direzione verso gli zeri e dai poles, come la deduciamo? Vedendo PS?
No. Abbiamo detto, we said that the poles are the starting points. Okay, so the poles, the open loop poles, corresponds to the value of K, which is zero. Here. So from these points,
also no, ma per esempio nel punto P1, perché la freccia va verso destra e non magari verso sinistra inizialmente proprio? Quando abbiamo...
Perché non va qua dentro?
Esatto, sì.
Vabbè, adesso ancora non lo sappiamo perché quello che vede che ho disegnato qui è negativo e quindi la curva deve stare sul luogo positivo. Ha capito?
Ok, sì.
Cioè non può uscire dall'altra parte perché quello è il luogo che è negativo.
Ok, ok.
E questo io lo so a priori, come vedremo adesso, tra le prime regole che avremo, ok?
Grazie mille.
Va bene. Ok, so... let's begin with the general properties of the... Ok, to fix some... to make some points clear from the beginning. Okay, so positive locus. How many curves? So this is an important point because we have to remember and take into account the number of curves we have to see on the root locus. So for the positive locus, remember, and this obviously is a consequence of the fact that the number of poles of the open loop system is n, but also the number of poles of the closed loop system is n, okay? And this is clear from this. If the denominator of P, okay, is at n degree polynomial, okay, the numerator, we are looking at the roots of the numerator of 1k plus k P, okay, is also equal to D of S plus K N of S, where P of S is N S. Okay, so N of S is the numerator of P and D of S is the denominator. So you see that the numerator of 1 plus K P S is D S plus K N S. So this is N degree. And this is m degree. So you see that this means that in the overall, this polynomial is n degree because n is greater than m. So this means that the roots are n, okay? So the number of poles of the open loop system is n, but also the number of poles of the closed loop system. So the number is the same. Okay. So on the root locus, if you keep in mind the fact that the points of the root locus represent the poles of the closed loop system, this means that you have to see on the root locus exactly n curves, one for each pole. Okay? So you will see on your root locus n curves moving or varying with k. Okay? So, in the root locus, you have n curves. Each starting from one pole. And this is the first point. N M curves the starting the okay correspond to the value of the parameter K zero. M curves will tend to the zeros for K tending to infinity. Okay. So the starting points for k equal to zero are the open loop points. And for m curves, the ending point in the limit are the zeros. The open loop zeros. Okay, later we will see what happens to the remaining curves. Negative locus. Okay, the negative locus basically has the same situation. The only difference is that, remember, that while for the positive locus k varies from zero to infinity, for the negative locus, k varies from minus infinity to zero. So if you see this, it is obvious that the directions on the negative locus are reversed with respect to the positive locus. Because k is coming from minus infinity toward zeros. So if k equals zero correspond basically to the poles, this means that now for the locus, the ending points of the curves become the poles. So also for the negative locus we have n curves, but each curve ends in the poles. And M will come from infinity, not tend to infinity. So and will enter the complex plane from infinity. Come from the zeros, basically. Excuse me, not infinity. Each ending in one pole so coming from the zeros Okay. So basically, the difference is that the directions are simply reversed. Okay. So this means that what you have to see in general, if we want to represent graphically the situation, is that for each pole you should see this negative locus, positive locus. So you see negative enters, positive exits. And this corresponds to k equals zero. And this curve, on this curve we have k less than zero and the other k greater than zero. For the zero, you have this. So entering for the positive, exiting for the negative. And this is K infinity, passing to K minus infinity. There is a sort of, like in the Nike's plot. You remember that in the origin, basically you jump from K infinity to K minus infinity through the same point. The same happens in the zeros. So from K infinity, you pass from the other side, minus infinity. Okay. So. Okay. So this is the point, the situation for locally around the poles and the zeros. What may happen is that the poles may be actually singular points. And this is clear, for example, from this here, you have two poles at zero. So when you represent, remember that for each value, for each pole, you have to use a cross. But if you have two poles, two crosses. Like in this example, you have two poles at zero here. So you have to represent at zero two crosses. So this is, we'll see this. Actually, this corresponds to a singularity in this point, in the sense that you have a multiplicity two exactly corresponding to the value zero of the parameter. So in these cases, you will not see only one curve entering and one curve exiting, but you will see more than one curve exiting and more than one curve entering. Okay, we will learn to handle this situation when we talk about singular points. Okay, so what I want to see, what I want to say is this, that in the case of PS equal 1 over S squared, this may be the negative locus, and this, the actually, this continues to be the negative locus, and this will be the positive locus. So you see that you are not seeing one curve for the positive locus and one curve for the negative locus only. But you see one and two for the positive locus and one and two for the negative locus. So two curves of the negative locus are entering and two are exiting. And the reason is that the multiplicity of the pole is two. Okay. I want to say that the examples here refer to a regular situation, a regular point. So multiplicity one. Okay. However, we must have the rule entering for positive locus in a pole, exiting from the negative locus, whatever is the number of the curves. And for the zeros, a similar situation, entering for the positive locus, exiting from the negative locus. Okay. So, actually, a simple motivation for which the starting point of the curves correspond, which are the poles. The open loop poles correspond to k equal to zero, comes from here. You see that the root locus equation corresponds to this, okay? So if k is equal to zero, you see that from the root locus equation, that P of S, or the point S, which correspond to k equal to zero, cannot be finite, because otherwise the equation should be, or is violated. Because zero, k is zero, if P of S is a finite value, cannot be equal to, the product cannot be equal to minus one because it's zero. So if k is equal to zero, necessarily P of S should tend to infinity to keep the product finite and equal to minus one. If k tend to zero, P of S must tend to infinity. When P of S tends to infinity, exactly corresponding to the poles of P. So for this reason, the value of k equal zero corresponds to the open loop poles in the root locus. Similarly, if k tends to infinity, what should happen to satisfy the root locus equation? You see that if k tends to infinity, to keep the product, keep kp finite equal to minus one, and P tends to zero. When P of S tends to zero, either the zeros, when S tends to the zeros, or else then. So, either s tend to either one zeros, or the modulo of s tends to infinity. Remember that p is strictly proper. Okay, so the degree of the denominator is greater than the degree of the numerator. So when s tends to infinity in module, p of s tends to zero, because the degree of the denominator is greater. Okay. And so you see, this is exactly what we said before. For k tending to infinity, m curves will tend to the zeros. And the other property says also that the remaining curves will tend to infinity. Okay. So basically what we can complement what we said in point one by saying that n minus for the positive locus n minus m curves the remaining ones m to the zeros n minus m to infinity tend to infinity for k tending to infinity. Okay. And the reason is that p of s in this way tends to zero, and so you satisfy the root locus equation. Okay. Negative locus. We have the same situation, but reversed. So for k, increasing from minus infinity. So this means that at infinity, for the positive locus, we should see something like this. So the curves going to infinity must have this direction. So going to infinity, and this k here is tending to infinity. On the other hand, for the negative locus, the curve is entering the complex plane. Okay. So k is increasing from minus infinity. And the curves are entering. Okay. So this is the first rule. So number of curves for each locus. How many curves? Which curve starts from a pole, open loop pole? M curves tend to the zeros, and the remaining ones to infinity. Now, two. How the root locus is distributed on the real axis. This is a very important information. Okay, I will use an example to illustrate the rule. This is a three poles, two zero example. You see that we have also two coinciding poles. Okay, the practical rule is this. You start always from your right. So here, on this side, you will always find a negative locus. So this means that this will be always negative locus. This. We have a change of locus each time we encounter a zero or pole according to the following rule. So we proceed from right to left. When we encounter an odd number of zero slash poles, odd number, we change locus. So in this case, we encounter one zero. So after the zero, we change the locus, positive. Next, we encounter two poles. This is an even number of zero poles. Zero slash poles. Okay? For this reason, we do not change locus. So we'll continue with positive locus. We next encounter one zero. So odd number of poles slash zeros. It's not important poles or zeros, either. It's the number which is important, odd or even. So in this case, you have one pole. So you change locus. Next, you encounter one pole and change again locus. So this is a heuristic rule, but gives the exact distribution of the root locus on the real axis. This is exact, we are not approximating. This is exactly how the root locus is on the root on the real axis. Okay, so this is the practical rule. Okay, if you want, you can also restate the same rule as follows. If you consider a generic point on these pieces, okay, so you consider a generic point, you have to look on his left or your right. If on his left, on its left, the left of the point, you see an even number of zero slash poles, this is a point of the negative locus. It's the same. As a matter of fact, on his left, you see you have zero poles or zeros, not zero. So even. It's even, okay? So this is a point of the negative locus. If you go here, this is a point of the positive locus because if you see on his left, on its left, you see one pole, which is an odd number. So that is a point of the positive locus. Also, any point here is the positive locus because you see on his left we have two poles and one zero, so three odd. Here is negative because you have two zeros and two poles, which is four, which is even. So it's a point of negative locus. And finally, this is a point of positive because you have 5 0 poles. So 3 poles and 2 zeros. And this is odd. Okay, you can see equivalently in this way. Either rule is okay. Okay.
Sì, non è che può ripetere questa seconda maniera di vedere.
So in this okay, the second way, completely equivalent, is as follows. So you consider each point, a generic point S for each piece of the real axis inside poles and zeros. Okay, so here you have to look at the left of the point, or if you want at the right of the point, looking at the root locus. Okay, so on this side. So if you see an even number of zero slash poles, the point is in the negative locus. As a matter of fact, you have no poles zeros, and so this is an even number. Actually, zero is considered as such. And so this is a point of the negative locus. If you go to the next point, S, here, if you look at your right from that point, or the left of it, of the point, which is the same, so from this point to in that direction, you see one pole, one zero, excuse me, and that's it. So one zero is odd. And so this point is in the positive locus. Okay. Is it clear?
Sì, grazie.
Devo procedere o ha capito?
No, no, ok, ho capito. Grazie.
Ok. Okay, basically the reason of this nice rule is this. If you consider a point S, this is exactly the vector S, excuse me, this vector is the vector S minus ZI. You see that the phase contribution of this vector is pi. The phase of this vector, because it's on the other side. Okay. Is rotated by pi with respect to the zero phase. Okay, while if you consider S on this side, this vector will have zero phase contribution because it's on this side. Okay, so if you think that the root locus equation is this. So basically, and P is in zero pole form. The positive locus is equivalently written in this form. So PS is equal to minus one over K when K is positive. So this means that the magnitude of P is 1 over K and the arg of P is minus, is pi plus 2H pi. H is a relative number. So this means that the phase is pi because you have the minus, okay? And K is positive. So the argument, the phase of PS minus pi pi plus multiples of 2 pi. Okay, so this means that a point of the positive locus such that the phase of PS is this up to multiple of 2 pi. Okay, since the phase of P is the sum of the phases of the terms like this and like this, so the denominator, numerator and denominator, and you can see that according to the position of S with respect to the zeros and poles, the phase contributions are pi if S is in this position with respect to the zero or pole, and zero if S is on this side of the zero or the pole, if you sum up all this contribution, exactly, you have this rule. So if S is here, basically you see that, which is the total up to here contribution in phase here, is the zero. So you see, is the contribution of this point in the face of PS is pi. Because we have this. And pi is the face which corresponds to of PS, which corresponds to S being a point of the positive locus. Okay, if you go now here, you have two poles. So the point S here, you see, has not only the contribution of the phase given by this zero, but also the contribution of the phase given by the two poles. Again, since S is on the left here, the poles are here and the zero is here. So you see that the total contribution to the phase of PS will be 3 pi. So 2 pi for these poles and pi for this zero. So the sum is 3 pi, but 3 pi is pi plus. Okay, for this reason, it is a point of the positive locus, and so on. So this is the simple consequence of this reasoning. Okay, so this is the second rule. Tomorrow we will see the remaining rules. Okay, we finish for today.